When we look at omega-3 and omega-6 fatty acids, it's important not to clump them all together and say omega-3 does this and omega-3 is good and omega-6 is bad, because actually there are multiple members of the family and they each do different things. For example, this is the one you've probably heard of in the omega-6 family. It's called arachidonic acid, otherwise AA. And this is the precursor. It acts as an ingredient to help with the inflammatory pathways. It doesn't lead to inflammation, but it helps it when inflammation is triggered. The one you don't hear about so much is DGLA, dihomogammalinolenic acid, which actually acts as one of the ingredients for the anti-inflammatory pathways. The reason why we hear so much about arachidonic acid is because actually this is found in high proportions in our cells, including animal cells. So when we eat animal products, such as meat and milk and dairy, these things actually end up in our bodies. So we have a high proportion of this, and then we're not actually getting these ones. So we're not getting the earlier substrates. So let's talk a little bit about that. First, in the omega-6 family, we've got linoleic acid. This is 18 carbons, two double bonds, and it's part of the omega-6 family. It then gets acted on by delta-6 desaturase. This enzyme does exactly what the name suggests. It desaturates. Saturation, remember, is the absence of double bonds. So what this does is it adds double bonds. So you can see here that now this had two double bonds, and now this one, GLA, gamma-linolenic acid, has three double bonds. And then what happens is it elongates, so it gets longer, adds carbons, and then it becomes dihomogammalinolenic acid, DGLA. So this has 20 carbons now, still the same amount of double bonds. The process goes on, and arachidonic acid has 20 carbons, four double bonds, and obviously all of these are part of the omega-6 family. Now, the reason why you probably don't hear about DGLA actually is because it's not really found in that many foods. Neither is GLA actually, and that's why we have supplements. They come in the form of borage seed oil and evening primrose oil. And this is the reason why people take supplements that have high GLA content. It's because then it gets converted into DGLA, which then acts as an ingredient for the anti-inflammatory pathways. And people take these for a whole number of reasons, heart and circulatory problems. This is not probably due to the cells themselves, which is what we've been talking about, but more so what the effect is on the blood vessels, which then has an effect on the heart. Eczema, behavioral disturbances, slow wound healing, sterility in males, miscarriages in females, arthritis-like conditions, those sorts of things. And most of those are issues of inflammation. And when you're thinking about inflammation, an easy way to remember it is think about all those words that end with itis. And those are the things, those are the symptoms that could be helped with improving the anti-inflammatory pathways. So moving up the chain, to go back to the parent, we see linoleic acid. And this is really abundant in our food sources. We consume it without probably really even knowing. We do most of the time. It's in a lot of processed foods, a lot of packaged foods. So if you see things like sunflower oil, safflower, corn oil, peanut oil, canola oil, olive oil even, these are all high in LA. And this is the reason why most people get a high amount of omega-6 in their diet, which is why they don't need to supplement with it. So the strategy actually is to reduce those fatty acids and go straight to GLA and get down to DGLA and then cut out AA in animal products. And the reason why AA is bad is because, as I mentioned before, if it builds up, then you've got more ingredient for the inflammation. If you actually reduce the inflammation, then AA will just sit there in the cells. AA is actually in a lot of our cells, and it's actually really important. Inflammation isn't always bad. So, for example, if you break your leg, AA will go in and it will be one of the ingredients to help you heal yourself. AA is also involved in, say, you did a workout. After that, the cells, they break and the AA spills out and it becomes an ingredient and it helps you repair your muscles. So arachidonic acid isn't bad on its own. It's really important for you. It's vital for your health even. But it's this problem of too much inflammation that is the real issue. And we'll get on to that when we talk about free radicals and oxidation. We're going to jump over to the omega-3 family now. And the first member of the family, the parent, is alpha-linolenic acid. And an important distinction is that this has like an N in it. And on the omega-6 family, it doesn't. So it's a slight difference in spelling. It can get kind of confusing. So alpha-linolenic acid, then it converts to a couple of things. These ones aren't as significant. But it's what we look at is EPA, eicosapentaenoic acid. And this one you can see has 20 carbons, so it's longer. It's got five double bonds instead of the starting one of three. And this one is involved also in anti-inflammatory pathways. So this is one that we want to look out for. Then it goes into DPA, and then it goes to DHA, which is probably the one you've heard of the most, docosahexaenoic acid. And this one is important because it's found as one of the preferential fatty acids of the brain. And the brain actually has its own enzymes that allow it to convert this in the brain. Some other organs that don't need it as much, say for example the heart, that doesn't have these enzymes there to convert ALA to DHA coming from the bloodstream. So it's a lot of research has been done on it, and it's definitely something that will help improve brain function. Now, what's important to know is that these enzymes, if you've noticed, these enzymes are actually shared by both pathways. So they actually compete. And this is the reason why we have this ratio, which you might have heard of, where people suggest that you have, for every one omega-3, then you have maximum four omega-6. And if you can balance those out, then even better. But this is the reason why we have this ratio. It's because they compete, and you need to get enough of your omega-3 without it competing with the omega-6 family. So you can see here that if you cut out your excess arachidonic acid, it will then stop competing with these enzymes to convert to DHA, and this is really beneficial. So in summary here, it's not that omega-6 is bad, it's just that if you are getting too much of the wrong substrate, then it could lead to an imbalance. And so your strategy should really be to decrease animal products, to increase GLA in this case, to decrease your processed foods, and just to make sure that your proportions of cooking with things like sunflower seed oil, corn oil, canola, and olive just balance along with the omega-3, so you're not getting, say, like 20 to 1, you're getting more like 4 to 1. And this is really where the issue is coming from. It's because of this imbalance. So to get your omega-3 fatty acids up, you can go straight down to the DHA and EPA. So these two are found in cold water fatty fish. So things like salmon, tuna, mackerel, sardines. And the reason why those fish actually have EPA and DHA in those amounts is because they eat smaller fish, and those smaller fish actually eat phytoplankton, and phytoplanktons are the ones that actually convert ALA to EPA and DHA for them. So eating that source straight away is pretty efficient, so that our body doesn't have to go through this stage, which does have limitations, especially if it's trying to compete with the omega-6 family over here. So what happens if you don't want to eat fish? Well, you can get your source of ALA from plant sources such as flaxseed, chia seeds. These actually then go through the same pathways to end up with EPA and DHA. And some of the arguments actually say that, your body can't convert ALA to DHA that efficiently. And this is, while this is true, it has been calculated that actually it can produce enough for your body's needs. The reason why we actually go for flaxseed oil is because of the processing. It's kind of shocking to find out how fish oil was processed. And they pretty much heat it up, they grind it, and then they put it through the pressing machines. So by heating it up, you introduce oxidation. And then afterwards, after you get all this oil, it smells. So they deodorize it with chemicals. And this is really bad in addition to the destroying of the actual oil in the first place. So when we turn to alternative sources such as flax, the downside, yes, is that you're not going straight to EPA and DHA. You are going from ALA. But the benefit is that flax seeds are pressed cold. They don't have to be heated. And some manufacturers will heat them, which is something to be careful of, because heating them does lead to the oxidation, which we'll get into when we talk about oxidation, free radicals, and inflammation. So flax seeds are our preferred source of omega-3, and we prefer it in capsules as well, because in bottles, every time you open the bottle, you're exposing it to the air, and so it can lead to more oxidation. And we just find it a really efficient way to take the supplements in terms of capsules as well. So what about eating the flax seeds whole? Our bodies can't digest these flax seeds, so actually if you just ate it, it would come out your other end and you could actually plant that and create a new plant. So you do need to grind them, and yeah, we just find it more convenient to have them in a capsule. When you grind it, also it's exposing it to air, but if you do it fresh yourself, then that's a really good way to get your omega-3. Chia seeds don't need to be ground. We put them in water and just leave them overnight, and they swell up to become little gelatinous type balls, and you can just drink it like that. ALA is also found in a lot of green leafy vegetables and some nuts. The only problem is that you have to eat a lot of it, and that's hard for most people.